All right, welcome everyone. And thank you for joining our webinar, Ideas, Written Word, and Research, How to Publish Your Article in a Scholarly Journal. Our guests today are Dr. Kimberly Griffin and Dr. L. Monique Ward. The discussion will be moderated by Marla Bonner, Project Manager for APA Publishing's HBCU Initiative. A few housekeeping notes. This webinar is being recorded and will be shared after the presentation. As you can see, we are using the ON24 platform, and you should see on your screen the media player and slides, as well as Q&A box, speaker bios, and additional resources. You can modify your view however you'd like, minimizing, maximizing, or moving various windows. Throughout the presentation, feel free to share your comments or questions in the Q&A box. Our presenters will do their best to answer your questions after the presentation. I'll now turn it over to Marla, who will introduce our guests.
Thank you, Barbara, and good afternoon, everyone. My name is Marla Bonner, and I am the project manager for APA Publishing's Equity, Diversity, and Inclusion Working Group's HBCU initiative. On behalf of the American Psychological Association, APA Publishing, and the APA Publishing Equity, Diversity, and Inclusion Working Group, I'd like to thank you so much for spending a part of your day with us and welcome you to today's webinar, Ideas, Written Word, and Research, How to Publish Your Article in a Scholarly Journal. So our panelists today are two dynamic, experienced leaders in the field of psychology who are eager to share some tips and tools with you about ways to navigate that scholarly publishing process. We're so honored to have with us Dr. Kimberly Griffin, Professor and Associate Dean for Graduate Studies and Faculty Affairs in the College of Education at the University of Maryland, and Editor-in-Chief of the APA Journal, Journal of Diversity in Higher Education. We're also honored to have with us Dr. L. Monique Ward, Professor of Psychology at the University of Michigan, Associate Editor for the Psychology of Women Quarterly, and co-author of a recent really fantastic article, by the way, in the APA Journal Psychology of Popular Media titled, Is That a Real Woman? Reality TV Viewing and Black Viewers' Beliefs About Femininity. So at the conclusion of their presentations, we will open the floor for a Q&A, so we encourage and look forward to your questions. So please be sure to drop your questions in the chat box. So without further ado, I will pass it over to our panelists.
Well, thank you very much for the invitation today, and thank you for that opening. So let's start with the beginning of the process. And the first step, of course, in getting published is producing a high quality manuscript to submit. Most of you already know how to do this, but I want to share a few insights that I've learned from my years as an associate editor with two different journals and my 25 years of experience mentoring graduate students, postdocs, and publishing on my own. So one of the first suggestions I have is that, not sure how to advance.
I got it.
First suggestion I have is that the literature review should tell a clear and compelling story. You are encouraged to be direct and clear about the importance of the question and your unique contribution. This is the why piece, the why should we care piece. You need to grab the reader up front and let them know why what you're asking and what you're doing is an important question. Sometimes I'd like to set up a paradox or point out the hole in the field that my work is trying to address. Something like, you know, most people think X or assume X is a prominent cause of Y or Z, but in fact, this has not been demonstrated. And then use what you can to point out why your finding is unique and what the unique hole is that you're contributing. It's also expected that you will explain the gap in the literature that needs to be addressed. Another suggestion about lit reviews, that you keep in mind that the lit reviews show that you've mastered a field, but you don't need to cite every paper in that field. Often it's good to cite a whole bunch in a parentheses and then maybe give an example or two. So again, it shows you've mastered the field, and then you can give some nice concrete examples that the reader can hang on to. And the lit review should follow a clear, logical organization, not just sort of paragraphs with subheadings, but again, a logical story where you're selling the importance of your piece and making logical arguments. I know you had some similar points. Did we lose our... Are there other points that you want to jump in? No, are any other points you want to jump in with?
Sure, I just wanted to add thing that, you know, oftentimes, particularly when I'm working with folks who are just starting to write their first journal manuscripts, that moving from reviewing the literature to actually synthesizing the literature can be a jump that can be hard to make. So when we're looking at literature reviews, we don't necessarily want to see, you know, abstract after abstract of different studies that are related to the study that you're doing, that we want you to construct an argument and use those different studies as evidence. So moving from series of abstracts, which might be kind of your first step in understanding literature and seeing the common threads across it, to really synthesizing and explaining an argument. And much like Dr. Ward shared, helping us understand what we know, what we don't know, and how your work fits into a larger discourse around a particular topic.
And then a second suggestion of producing a high quality manuscript is to make your points clear and use accessible language. We encourage you to watch your jargon. You don't necessarily need to use overly fancy words. Try to be simple and direct. And if there are terms that, you know, are important terms in terminology, to explain them as they're introduced as you go. But on the flip side, you also have to make sure that the language is not overly casual. I mean, you want to sell it and tell a compelling story, but we are scientists reporting science, and make sure to keep it formal but not too jargony. And you want to clearly articulate what your findings mean in your results section, and, you know, again, letting us know what you found and why it is important. And then a third suggestion is that writing for an academic journal is a skill. You can learn it and you can improve if you need to. I see writing as a skill that you can continuously improve on. And publications are our currency as a scholar, so good writing is important. And sometimes get in the way of telling a really compelling and interesting story. And I have found over the years that academic paper writing is actually sort of formulaic. You know, if you have a standard single study paper that's like 35 pages long, they usually try to shoot to have the cover, the abstract, and the lit review maybe take up the first 10 pages. Then you have the method at 5 pages, results at 5 pages, discussion at 5 pages, references at 5 pages, and then tables and figures pick up 5 pages, and that's 35 pages. Sketchy guide, but it keeps you in check sometimes. If your discussion is running 10 pages long, that might be too much. If you're lit review, maybe you need more. So that's kind of a guideline. And writing is pretty formulaic. You can get guides to it. If you don't really have a formula yet, you can purchase some and talk to people. And I also recommend that you read good papers, not just for the content, but for writing techniques. You know, if they explain something really well, you know, when I was a graduate student, I would write in the margin, oh, well put. And I would try to remember that about the, how they explained a concept or an idea so that I could use similar language, or they set a story up really well. It was really informative to read good writing to then help you produce good writing. And you had similar suggestions as well, Kimberly?
Yeah, absolutely. So the one thing that I would add to that, everything that Dr. Ward said, brilliant and totally on point. One of the early pieces of advice I got was to have two model articles as I was trying to craft my own, that I should find an article that talked about the same topic that I was trying to talk about, just to help me understand, like, how were people constructing arguments around similar ideas as my own? So a study that's similar in terms of topic that I might cite in the context of my paper. And then a model article that had the same methodology as mine to kind of help me see, how did this person set up their method section? How did they actually explain their data and tell a story with their data? And having those two models was always really, really helpful to me in terms of figuring out how was I going to put my work in a way that a journal editor and reviewers would be able to make sense of.
Totally. Oh, that's such a great suggestion, the model article one. So let's move on to a couple more. Another thought is that we acknowledge that writing can be daunting. So the recommendation is that you break it up into chunks and that you schedule time to write. the breaking it up into chunks, you know, one piece at a time. Often folks, when they write the articles, they don't necessarily start with the lit review and go through. I actually like to start with the tables and the results. So get that down first. What do I have? What have I found? Start with my tables. And that's pretty doable, making those tables. And then the methods. And then I do the intro and the discussion. So break it up into chunks. And you were saying that you often have an outline.
I do. So I drive my students and my collaborators crazy because I'm always asking, what's the story we're trying to tell? What's the story we're trying to tell? And so any outline that I have at the top will kind of be like, what's the problem? What's the purpose? What are the research questions? And what's the argument? Like, what is the argument that this paper is trying to make? And so then I'll kind of outline each section, and that way I can start anywhere. If we all know we're coming to the end, like the same end point, that we're all trying to make the same point, we can farm out different sections of the paper. I certainly am not writing the whole paper from beginning to end, particularly when I work with a team, that we're all writing different chunks of it. But we all know, like, we are trying to make this argument at the end of the day. So make sure that whatever you write kind of keeps this point in mind and keeps coming back to the same point. So I find outlining, I know a lot of times it feels like it's time consuming and that it's not real writing. And I think it's really, really critical, important writing time to be spent, particularly if you're working with the team.
Totally agree. And even with the outlining, as you're pointing out, that's a strategy that people use to start with this outline and whatnot. And so definitely try to develop strategies for writing, either leaving a certain amount of time to write each day or picking a day of the week to write. I know there are different methods that are out there to get you writing, because the goal is to sort of get into rhythm. Because I find that the more you do it, sort of the better and easier it is. And you want to sort of make it so it's not painful to write. So whatever strategy works for you would be something good to try. Did you have any other strategy ideas, or should we move on to the next point?
Sure. I just wanted to add one quick strategy. I don't know if folks have heard of the Pomodoro method before, but you can download Pomodoro timers from online spaces, or you can just set a timer on your phone. But it's 25 minutes, and it suggests that people work best in 25-minute chunks. And it's easier to say, I'm going to focus for 25 minutes and then take a break for five, than it's, I'm going to write for 4 hours, or I'm going to write, you know, for 5 hours. And I find that my mind wanders a lot. So one of the things I like about the Pomodoro method is if I'm working in my 25-minute chunk and I can look up and see a timer and my mind starts to wander, I know exactly how much longer I still have to focus. I wonder what's going on in my email. Oh, wait, I only have to focus for 5 more minutes. I can stay focused on this for 5 more minutes, and then I get to check my email, or I get to send that text message that was on my mind. And you can accomplish so much more than you think in 25 minutes. And even if you can't, like, perfectly write out your prose, you can write in all caps, you can write down ideas and come back and continue to refine them and decide, I'm going to write 3 Pomodoros this morning, or I'm just going to write for one. But I've found that that 25-minute time period goes quickly, but you can get a lot done in it.
Yeah. I know you and I went over a few other thoughts. Another suggestion is to get feedback on drafts from trusted colleagues. So when you have a decent enough draft, you know, submit it to people in your lab, people outside your lab, to get a different set of eyes, a senior advisor that you know in the field or something like that. I think getting feedback can be very useful. Presenting it at a conference can often be useful for getting feedback from others, or presenting it at someone's lab meeting. So I think it's good to get feedback before you submit to a journal. And then also a point we wanted to point out, that multiple drafts are typically needed for a publishable paper. I tell my students, like, 8 to 10 drafts make a publishable paper. It may not be that many, but the point is that you need to work and rework, you know, to make it better and better. And you see the drafts getting stronger, you know, with each iteration. But I also want to remind you, too, that parsimony is a beautiful thing. Saying your idea in this concise way, clear and concise, can be really beautiful. If you don't want it to be too long, the people aren't going to want to read it, or no one's going to want to cite it, you know, so try to get your point across in a concise way, and that could be really special. And then the last thing about writing, by the way, is I want to make sure we get to the other points, is just proofread. You know, as an editor, if you see manuscripts with errors in them, typos in them, it makes reviewers question, they aren't careful here, how careful were they with the science? You just want to try to make sure to look over for typos and don't even rely on spell check. You want to make sure that you read it through and that there aren't typos or words missing or things like that. Any other points here before we move to the next recommendation?
Sure. I just wanted to add really quickly. I know that sometimes, you know, particularly when we're applying for funding, either to support us in our dissertation work or for small grants, you might want to build in some money for an editor if it's possible. I'm seeing our students and even colleagues out in the field increasingly using editors to catch some of those proofreading things. I think when our heads are so into the data and telling the story, it's really easy to miss how you can clean your language up and tell your story in a clearer way. So if you have some wiggle room around those things, there's tons of folks who are really great editors and will do it fairly reasonably as well.
Great, so let's move to the next set of suggestions. You have this amazing high quality manuscript that's ready to submit. So the next step is picking a journal outlet to submit it to. Where does it go? And we know that journals differ in a number of important ways, including the audience of readers, is it a mainstream journal, or more of a niche and specialty journal, exposure, right, how widely it's read and cited, the type of papers that the journal takes. So it takes some thought and some effort to find the appropriate journal home for your article. And then you may take a few tries in the end. So we had a few suggestions for you about picking a journal outlet. One thing to think about as you think it through, hence our little thinking head. So as you think it through, one of the things is, well, who are the findings relevant for? Is it something that all of psychology should know and be interested in? Is it more appropriate for your specific subfield? I'm a developmental psychologist, so some thoughts may be more relevant for developmental psychologists than other fields, or even a subfield within it. Who's going to be most intrigued by this finding that you produce? So think about the innovation that your study is making. Who would be most receptive to or intrigued by the innovation? And what audience would sort of get the most and see it as a cool finding and a cool contribution?
The one thing I would add to that, I'm so sorry, go ahead. The one thing I'd add is that, so I'm actually a professor in a college of education, and my journal is a partnership between APA journals and a community of practice, the National Association of Diversity Officers in Higher Education. So folks who write for us are in many ways writing to individuals who are doing diversity and inclusion work on college and university campuses. So folks who are really interested in seeing whatever it is they study put into practice in very direct ways tend to be attracted to our journal. So also thinking about whether what you're saying is something that could translate to specific interventions or specific practices. There are some, I know a lot of folks in psychology are often studying, you know, different phenomena that take place with college students. So are you thinking maybe about wanting to influence student affairs practitioners or faculty members? There's an increasing amount of work on science and dynamics in terms of increasing access and equity in STEM fields. Maybe you want to write for a journal that's looking specifically to science faculty members or folks who are trying to do diversity and inclusion work in science. So being mindful about how your work will be used as well and whether or not it has direct implications for practice can also be helpful.
So I think those are such great suggestions in terms of thinking about the journal. Other things to help you make a decision about which journal, we recommend, for example, investigating the editorial board. You can look and see who they typically send the papers to as reviewers. Are the kind of people at this journal, can they correctly critique your work? Are they knowledgeable about the topic and the methods that you use? So that's something to think about. You also want to investigate the kinds of articles that are published in the journal. So to establish the fit question, you have to go beyond the name of the journal, and you should check to see what kind of articles they're publishing in the journal. Look at some of the recent issues, look at the ones that are about to come out soon in their queue. Do they take the kind of work that you do? Look at the samples, is it adolescent, is it adult? Look at the kind of studies, is it qual versus quant? Is it, you know, surveys versus experiments, you know, to find the best match? Is it the time frames that they typically publish? Is it only mostly longitudinal studies? Are they okay with cross-sectional studies? Do you need multiple studies or single studies? These are definitely some of the things you can investigate. And do you have other suggestions?
Just one. So my journal in particular, and I know some others, have a mission statement, and ours is a little bit longer and gives folks some context and some ideas of what types of articles we're actually looking for. So checking that mission statement is also helpful. You can always email the editor as well. Every once in a while, I do get an email that says, hey, this is what my work is on. Is it a fit for your journal? And it's helpful sometimes to see that. I always hope that someone's looked at the mission statement first, but a lot of times there is something tricky about the manuscript that makes me like, oh yeah, I get why you're emailing me about whether or not it's a fit.
Oh yeah, that's good to know. Do I look at the mission statement? That's good to know.
Let the editor know you looked at the mission statement.
What else do we want to suggest? You might want to investigate statistics, you know, like impact factors. Each journal has an impact factor based on how often that individual article is cited. And so there's sort of top tier ones, middle tier, lower tier. So if it's important to you, especially if you're maybe going up for tenure soon or whatever, to get some top tier ones, you can investigate those numbers. You can also look at the publication queue. You know, what is your time frame? If you need to get studies out quickly, looking for a job on the job market, going up for tenure, you maybe can ask around which journals have a short and fast publication process and which have longer ones. I remember asking that when I was going up for tenure, like, what's a good journal that publishes fast? And I would ask people that, and it was helpful because I got articles out quickly. So that's something that you could ask. And you're saying that, where would you find that information if you needed it?
So you can find that information. There's an online resource called Cables, C-A-B-E-L-L-S, that documents most journals. So you can just go in there and search, and it will tell you the impact factor, rejection rates, and all kinds of other good things. But a lot of times on the journal website, that information will be there. If it's not, again, you can email the editor. A lot of editors have a production assistant, so somebody who's kind of managing the behind the scenes nuts and bolts pieces of the journal, and they can usually give you an answer to those questions as well, like what the rejection rate is, what's the time to publication. And again, you know, we expect those types of questions, so.
Good. And then the last couple of things I just wanted to recommend, investigate the article parameters for the journals in terms of length. Usually length is a big issue. Sometimes journals publish what their typical length is, and you have to sort of stick to that. Sometimes journals don't. And then finally, we suggest that you compile a list of possible options. One of my colleagues, when she gets ready to submit, she usually compiles a list of like 3 to 5 journals that it could potentially go to. And she often starts with something high and aspirational that it's not likely to get into. But you get good feedback. If you get it reviewed, you get the feedback from that one, and then you could send it to the second journal in which you've incorporated that feedback. Maybe that's the one you really want to get into. But if you start with a list of possibilities, that's important. And then you may need to reframe your intro or discussion to fit the journal that you end up picking. So you just have to be mindful that different journals have different expectations and themes. If it's a race journal or a gender journal, you may have to frame your story somewhat different to fit that journal. Did you want anything else about journal before we move on to the next domain?
The one thing is one of a really good piece of advice I got early on, because it can be overwhelming. There's so many journals to try to like narrow down which ones are the best ones or the best fits for your different manuscripts. Someone once recommended to me, look at what journals you're citing. And chances are pretty good that if you're citing a certain journal over and over again, it's probably a good fit for your piece too, right? So I think I would often look at my reference list as I was trying to figure out a good home for my journal and see like, oh, I've cited, you know, the Review of Higher Education like 6 times. Maybe this should go to the review. Or I've, you know, cited the Journal of Student Affairs Research and Practice a whole bunch of times. This might be a good fit for that journal this go around. So take a look at your reference list. Sometimes it gives you some good hints about where you might want to send something.
Great suggestion. Yes, that's what I do too. And in the end, with the journal makes a huge difference for success. So that's something to keep in mind. So once you've selected your first journal choice, there are some things to keep in mind as you submit. And I realize, my goodness, our time is going fast. I'm going to go through these quickly. So to keep these things in mind when you're submitting the manuscript, you need to be mindful of the specific formatting required for submissions. So in terms of length, how they set up their abstracts, some journals want you to number sections or number hypotheses or have different formatting for the references. Most of APA, but some have different ones. Remember, we had a journal that had different pixels for your images and get their parameters to keep in mind. Make sure you included all the required paper elements. Some journals now, for example, want you to have a practice implication section in your discussion, a theory implications in your discussion. So make sure you've included all of those. The cover letter to the editor should try to highlight some of the key contributions. So the editor is usually the only one that's going to see the cover letter, but if you can make sure to sell why this study is unique and important to them in the cover letter, that can maybe get you at least a review and not rejected. And if possible, suggest potential reviewers. It's critical who the reviewers are. You want knowledgeable ones who are open to the kind of research you're doing. So it's recommended, if you can, to suggest potential viewers. Some websites have that for you, some don't, but I think it's really recommended. And we want to point out that submitting takes time and patience. It can take almost a day sometimes to submit the manuscript. Some journals have very specific requirements. Maybe the text goes in one submission folder versus the tables versus the references. You have to see what the requirements are. You often have to set up a password. And there could be a lot of rules and pieces. So just take your time, a lot amount of time to submit the manuscript. Any other thoughts there, or should we move to the what happens next step?
I think we should just keep moving.
Okay. So you submitted your manuscript. So what happens next? We'll give you a brief overview of the publication process.
Okay, so what happens next? So you submit your manuscript, it goes in, and the first person who usually sees it is the editor. So I'm gonna kind of take you through the process from the perspective of the way that we do it at the Journal of Diversity in Higher Education, and I think it's pretty similar to what happens at other journals as well. So I get a manuscript and I make what's called a desk decision about the manuscript. So I take a read of it and I decide whether or not it's going to go out for review. So either I'm going to select reviewers for it, or I'm going to give it to one of my associate editors to select reviewers for it, or we'll make a decision which is called a desk rejection. So it did not get out sent out for review, but there's usually some issue with the manuscript that makes us feel like we should not move it forward in the process. One of those issues often is it's not a fit for the journal, so maybe the topic isn't quite in alignment with what we usually publish. Sometimes I can do a read of the manuscript and see it still needs a little bit more work. There are some challenges associated with the work that means that it probably isn't going to be very successful in our process. So rather than take up the time of, you know, sending it out and waiting the months that it takes to get reviews back, let me just make a decision on it right now, but also give the author some feedback. So usually if you get that desk decision and you hear that it's not going to move forward in the process, you get some feedback associated with what would make the manuscript stronger when you want to resubmit it to another journal. So let's say you get through that first stage of the process and I'm either keeping it or I'm giving it to one of my associate editors. We then look at the manuscript and choose a group of folks who are going to review it, and they're going to review it without knowing who you are. Most journals engage in a blind review process. So the editor knows, or the associate editor knows your identity, but the reviewer does not, and you don't know who the reviewer is. So they choose somebody based on alignment of their interests. Sometimes you'll choose somebody that has a particular insight in terms of the methodology that you used to read the manuscript and to offer it feedback. So they'll read it. They'll usually type up some notes. There'll be a small subsection of notes that they share only with the associate editor or with me. But then they have more copious notes that they're going to share with the author. In addition to offering their feedback, they offer a recommendation to the editor or the associate editor about one of three decisions. So should the article be accepted as is, which almost never, ever, 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 ever happens. or accepted with few revisions or whatever, but the decision is accepted. So usually that does not happen on the first try. They'll say, there's some good promise here, but we have some feedback and we'd like them to revise it and resubmit it for further consideration, or we're going to reject the manuscript. I think one of the things that, you know, Dr. Ward and I both want you to walk away from this session knowing is that if you get a revise and resubmit, that's a win. Like, it feels frustrating because it wasn't ultimately accepted, but you're, the way I describe it to my students is, you're still in the game. You're still in the game. You still have an opportunity to revise your work. And hopefully the reviewers have given you good substantive feedback, and the editor then too has synthesized that feedback. You know, one of my jobs as reading the feedback that the reviewers have given, doing my own read of the manuscript and highlighting, like, these are the things I really want you to pay attention to as you go through and revise the work. So let's say you get a revise and resubmit. You get the paper back. You'll get a certain amount of time to review the feedback that you've gotten and to incorporate it into the manuscript. And usually the editor or the associate editor wants to see how you've responded to each point. So you probably want to create an Excel table or a Word document. That's usually what I do with each point of feedback that's been offered and how you responded to it. There's a difference between fixing everything someone told you to fix and responding to everything. You don't necessarily have to make all of the changes that are recommended, but you do have to respond to each change. So you have to say, if you disagree, for example, with a suggestion about your pseudonyms, or if you disagree with a way that somebody has recommended that you organize your findings, you can say, like, you know, I appreciate that point. I'm organizing it this way for this reason. So you have to offer some additional context if you're not going to make the change. But if you are going to make the change, it's really, really helpful to the reviewer if you say, yes, I made this change, here's where the change is, and here's what I did. Because ultimately what you're going to do is send your manuscript back revised, as well as these documents that say, this is how I fixed things that people suggested that I fix. And it's going to go back to the same reviewers, and they're going to look at it again, and they're going to kind of assess how you incorporated their feedback and make another decision on the paper. And again, they can decide, you know, yep, they did a great job. We're going to accept the manuscript now. They did a great job, but there's still some things that we want you to address. You need to revise it and resubmit, or we're going to reject the paper. Oftentimes, it's going to go through a few rounds of revise and resubmit. You know, that's happened to me many, many times. I'm sure it's happened to Dr. Ward many times as well. But ultimately, you do get to that final accept decision a lot of times. Sometimes, of course, you know, your paper still can get rejected in that process. But I found that, you know, once you kind of get in that cycle of revise and resubmit, and if you're really working hard to address the feedback that's being given to you, that oftentimes that does result in an accepted manuscript over time. Am I forgetting anything, Dr. Ward?
I don't think so. And then we have a summary slide in the next one so we can remind them.
Okay.
You want me to go to the summary slide?
Yeah, that'd be great. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay, yeah. So you pointed out so many things to think about. So with the reviews and revision, we just want to remind you that it is a golden opportunity. You know, it's still in the game, like you said, Dr. Griffin, it's your opportunity to make it better, to make it stronger if you get this revise and resubmit, and usually they end up being better. So you haven't gotten thrown out yet. And we reminded you that doing revisions is cognitively taxing. So consider some sort of organizational plan, especially if there are multiple authors, and you may need to make a table about who's doing what. And Dr. Griffin suggested maybe a Excel sheet or something like that. So we're just acknowledging that it is hard. It's hard to keep three reviewers' comments, and the editor sometimes has comments, and you have to keep them all coordinated and respond to them. But we do suggest that you respond to each item raised by the reviewers, and you gave many suggestions on how you respond. Be kind and respectful and thorough in your response letter. Do the best you can. These reviewers are volunteers, and they're also busy people, and they have read your manuscript. So you have to be kind and respectful in the responses back. Sometimes if you give like a snarky review or something like that, try not to be snarky in your response back. Be as kind and as respectful as you can. And then we're reminding you that revision is part of making the papers better. You know, it's a process that we all go through, and usually there's multiple rounds of revisions. But in the end, they're often better manuscripts. So then we were going to move on to thriving and surviving, because much of what happens in academia is rejection. You know, rejection is a big part of our process. So we wanted to acknowledge sort of this emotional side of all this. We just went through the mechanics, but there is an emotional side. Academic publishing is not easy. It can be emotionally humbling. You know, you're sending your little babies out there, your intellectual spawn. They're out there in the world to get torn down and worked over. So you have to have a thick skin. But we remind you that rejection is part of being an academic. It's completely normal. I tell my students being an academic is a lot like being an actor. You're going to get rejected like 90% of the time. We're talking manuscripts, we're talking grant proposals. So it's a typical normal part of academia. You just sort of have to learn how to handle it. Don't be discouraged. Maybe take that data, stomp around. Man, I can't believe they rejected it. What's wrong with those people? And then take the next day, get back on the horse. Okay, how can we fix it? How can we move it forward? So I just wanted to acknowledge that it's part of it. Sometimes, often rejection is a matter of fit. Maybe that first journal you sent it to wasn't a good fit. It may not even be about the quality of the work. It might just be, you know, you have to find your appropriate journal home. And for many pieces, there is a home. You just have to find the right one. And a good way to sort of thrive and survive is to celebrate every phase of the process along the way. This process can be challenging and taxing, so it's important to acknowledge and celebrate the milestones. You know, you have data, yay! You did your analysis and they work, yay, celebrate. You finished that first full draft, that's amazing, you go you, celebrate that. And celebrate the submitted part, because that is a big accomplishment to get a manuscript submitted, because it can often take years to go from beginning to submission. So you do need to celebrate along the way and feel good about those things. Did you want to add in, or should I finish the last 2 points? Uh-oh, I don't hear you. Okay, I'm going to keep going.
Yeah, there you are. Okay, you hear me now? Okay. Yeah, the one thing I would share about rejection is know that it is an experience that every single academic has had. It is a shared experience. There is no academic that has not gotten a rejection letter, and we all get in our feelings about it. Give yourself the time to be in your feelings about it, and then keep it moving. I really, really appreciate Dr. Ward's comment that I always try to frame it as like, every piece has a home. Every piece has a home. Just haven't found the home yet. It might be a journal article. It may end up being a book chapter, but there are very few manuscripts in my career that I've started that haven't landed somewhere. It may not have been the place that I originally intended for it to land, but they ultimately all land somewhere. So just know that every piece has a home, and don't give up and don't get discouraged. This is such a process of continuing to show up every day and continuing to chip away and continuing to make your work better. So,
totally. And one of the ways to help is to participate as a reviewer when you can. As an associate editor and a fellow scholar, I encourage you to participate as a reviewer when asked, and if the topic is relevant. It's a great way to see cutting-edge work in the field, to improve your own writing and critical thinking skills, to learn techniques about how to prepare materials, how to respond to reviewers. You get to see the reviews come back from other people. Plus, it's part of the volunteer cycle. You know, I've been told that for every paper you send out, 3 people are reading your work, so you should agree to do 3 other reviews just to keep the cycle going. So say yes as a reviewer when you can. You learn so much in the process. And then just to piggyback with what you were saying before, you need to be patient. It's a long process. There are often multiple rounds of revisions, rejections, as you look for the right home. And it's a long game. You got to prepare yourself for the long game, because academia is about delayed gratification. So that's why you got to celebrate the little victories along the way.
Can I add one thing about patience? So I think particularly during these times right now, the process has always taken a long time. Right now it's taking an extra long time. So if you submit something, you may not hear anything for a long time. And I know it is extremely tempting, like even though we have online management systems that tell you where your paper is in the process, I can't tell you how many times I get emails that say, Dr. Griffin, can you please let me know where my paper is in the process? And, like, I understand the stress and anxiety associated with that, and I'm always happy to respond to those things. It usually does not help the process go any faster. And the advice that I got early in my career is that the only thing you have control over is what you send out the door. You have no control over how long it takes. You have no control over how long your reviewers are taking, or like the fact that this editor won't answer you. Like, all you have control over is what you are sending out the door. So focus on that. Know that we have not lost your paper. It's just taken a long time, especially right now. But, you know, we're engaging with it and happy to engage with you. But just focus on the parts that you have control over.
Yes, and then one of the last things I wanted to say, because I definitely want to leave 15 minutes for questions, is that one aspect of sort of thriving and surviving involves feeling relevant, right? Feeling that our research is contributing to the greater good. I know that many of us got into psychology or are seeking to get a PhD in psychology in order to help change the world, to improve conditions somehow for humankind. And you may be wondering, how is publishing in an academic journal that's only read by other academics really going to do anything? So I just want to push back on that assumption a little bit and to remind you that now more than ever, doing good science is important. It is the foundation. We all need science. We all need data to support our beliefs, our efforts towards advocacy and towards justice. So doing good science is important and should be the foundation of advocacy. And that doing good science, and if you do good science, advocates will often come find you. You know, they need data to support their white papers, their testimonies, or whatever. So if you do good science and get it published, just be patient, because after a while, the advocates will come find you. I'm sure senior scholars can probably tell you many stories about, you know, their experiences with advocacy. And, you know, I have a few of my own that I wanted to share. I mean, I've been doing my research in developmental psychology and gender and media and kids for 25 years. And in that time, advocates have found me. I remember one day I got a phone call from the Children's Defense Fund. I was so excited. I think I saved the message on my machine for like months. And when Marion Wright Edelman called me because she was doing a project and wanted stuff I wanted to help out, I'm like, And of course, funding went away. We didn't end up doing it, but it was pretty exciting. And I did some testimonies for the U.S. Senate, some APA reports, some presentations for toy companies about stereotypes and toys, and work with children's media. And then, of course, I did a presentation for the Obama White House on stereotypes in media and toys. So my science, you're publishing your science. The advocates will come find you, and then you could do all these other things that could help change the world. And then I want to advance, because I know you wanted to add something else, Dr. Griffin. Oh, once again, sound.
Huh. Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Share your peer-reviewed work on Twitter. Share it. It will lead to, from what we're seeing, it will lead to being cited more, and oftentimes will lead to folks being more aware of the kinds of work you do. So I have some stories similar to Dr. Ward's. Nothing as good as Marion Wright Edelman calling me to work on a project. It's amazing. But there are times when I've been invited to do talks, and I've asked, how did you find me? Or how did you find my work? And I'm like, I found you on Twitter because you tweeted about something that you wrote. Or I wrote this very, very, very long piece that was ultimately like a very thorough literature review, but spoke to how institutions can transform their campuses and work on faculty diversity-related issues. And I tweeted about it because there was a window where it was going to be available for free download. And last time I checked, it had been downloaded 3,000 times. So tweet about your work. Share about your work online. Like, it's a really great way to disseminate it in new and different ways. So we wanted to close. I think this is the end of our formal comments, right? And we'll address a couple of Yeah, what's the editor looking for? So I've addressed a couple comments and questions in the chat, but we're happy to spend the remaining time talking about those questions and comments. And I'll just go over this really quickly. So, you know, we talked a little bit about the process and, you know, that the editor or the associate editor, in a lot of cases too, gets this manuscript and they ultimately get to decide whether or not it's going to go out for review or even when the reviews come back. Sometimes there's a little bit of a fuzzy line there between whether or not it's a paper that should continue in the process or what one that we should reject. So people ask all the time, like, what are you looking for? What like kind of leads you to make a discernment between rejecting a manuscript and pushing it forward? And I just wanted to outline six things that I think about, particularly in the context of the Journal of Diversity in Higher Education, but I think more generally can apply to other journals as well. So one we already talked about a fair amount. How does this work align with the journal's mission and scope? Does it speak to the kinds of things that we're known for? And if it does, then I'm more likely to be an advocate for it. Second, that is there a familiar structure? Are all the parts included? Are there, you know, no glaring omissions? So, you know, sometimes I get papers that like have no lit review or have no conceptual framework or have no discussion, or the methods is one page. You know, does it look like other manuscripts that are in our journal? So again, speaking to some of the points that Dr. Ward made earlier about, you know, making sure that the format is consistent with what the journal publishes, that there's methodological rigor there, that we can see that, you know, this is really good research, and that there's an alignment between what you want to know and how you went about answering that question. So you have research questions that make sense given the work that you've done and the data that you're presenting. You'd be surprised how often that those pieces don't fit together, right? So that everything should be in a straight line. And I often say, like, I should be nodding as I read the manuscript, like, yeah, this totally makes sense. This totally makes sense, that I can almost anticipate what your design would be given what your research questions are. This point is really one of the most important things. That there are times when I get manuscripts that are beautifully written, like well situated in the literature, all the right pieces are there, but I didn't learn anything. That like I ultimately, they're just like, yep, yeah, and what we found is consistent with what everybody else found on the exact same topic, and I have nothing to add to the discourse. And that for me, those are not the types of manuscripts that we're looking to publish. That you want to really think about, how does your work speak to what we already know and extend and go beyond that? Like, and it's almost always the case that it's there. You just need to sit with your data a little bit more. You have to think about how you're telling your story, and that certainly we can confirm extant work, but how do we push beyond what we already know? For my journal, again, practical implications are super important. A lot of our readers are working on college and university campuses every day to try to transform them and to make them more just and more equitable. So what is someone who's reading this manuscript supposed to do with it? How are they ultimately supposed to go out into the field and make change? And then, you know, finally, I always want to know the so what. And I have this conversation with my students all the time, particularly when they're working on their dissertations. And I always preface it with, like, please don't read this as me not caring about your work. I care about your work. But how are you going to convince somebody else that this matters and this is urgent and we really need to look at this right now? How are you going to situate your work in a way that speaks to the current context, what's happening out in the world? Why should I care? Why should I read this? And really kind of tying back into that makes me more invested in the things that I read.
That sounds wonderful.
Awesome. Yeah. So we have some questions in the chat that we can certainly touch on. There was one that just popped up that I think might be helpful to talk about. So I think that the difference between moving in and synthesizing the literature. So for me, the way that I like to describe this is that sometimes when my students review the literature, it'll be like going through a forest and pointing at trees and going, there's a pine, there's an oak, there's eucalyptus over here. Like they talk about each tree as separate from each other, and above the forest saying, so the pines go this way, and then there's a river, and then over this way, there are oak trees. And then it's really weird. There are these eucalyptus trees on this side, and we're not used to seeing eucalyptus trees here, right? Like that they're not constructing an argument about how different pieces fit together, about what's similar and what's different about them. And that's ultimately what a review of literature is supposed to do. It doesn't give us abstracts of each individual paper. It gives us a sense of how discourse is being had about a topic and a group of papers that are similar in one way, and another group of papers that are similar in another way, and then maybe a group of papers that are a little bit divergent or give us a different perspective. But it's ultimately making an argument about the state of the literature rather than telling us about each individual paper that has been written on your topic. Does that help or make things a bit more clear?
That's for me.
Yeah.
There apparently are a lot of questions in the chat.
To look at some of them as well.
There's a lot.
Yeah.
What is the
So what is considered synthesized?
I'm sorry, could you repeat that?
We did the synthesize. What is considered concise? How long should it be approximately before it's considered too lengthy? and I think with the length question, it will depend a lot on the journal. Like for me, my rule of thumb, like for lit reviews, that's the first one. I mean, I've seen lit reviews that are going like 20 pages long. And it's like, you can't follow the story if it's that much there, you know? So definitely work within the parameters of the article and just try to have sort of a rule of thumb. Lit reviews really should try to end close to 10 pages. If you're going past 20, it's just too much. And it's hard for the reader to follow your wonderful story. So try to, you know, work for parsimony, but it will depend on the journal. Some journals, they only have 30 page articles. And so your lit review has to be short and concise, or medical or public health journals are even shorter than that. So it's hard to say exactly because it will depend on the journal and the subfield. But if you can get other people to read it for you, they'll probably give you a sense of, hey, I love this point, but it went on for 5 pages. Can you cut it to 1? That's why getting some eyes is helpful. Did you have some other comments, Dr. Griffin? Yeah. I don't hear your sound.
Oh, yeah.
Can you hear me now?
There you go.
Very great. One of the things that someone once told me a long time ago that I always remember is that if I have a sentence that starts with, in other words, I'm being redundant. Like, I could have said it one time. So it means I said something, and then I tried to say it more clearly the second time. Choose one or the other. So just be mindful of, like, are you repeating yourself over and over again because you're trying to get more clear? Like, if you can just say it once, that's great. And another set of eyes is always super helpful. So it's really hard to cut your own work, but I always say I cut like a surgeon for my friends. So get a good friend who's very like parsimonious and very straightforward to be like, you don't need, like, I remember I remember reading one of my own papers once and like reading the introduction and reading down a page and a half and realizing that the paper really started about a page and a half in. Like, just being like, no. You know, like, I didn't need any of the first page and a half. I was just warming myself up. And I very much believe in writing yourself where you need to be, because sometimes we need to put those words on the paper so that we can get ourselves to that clarity of thought that's necessary. And as much as it hurts to hit delete on those words, they were absolutely necessary to get to the clarity of thought, but don't be afraid to hit delete on those words.
Now, do you really delete them? Because I never delete.
I'll put them in another document.
Yeah, store it in another document. You can use it for another paper. I have my parked text file where I've parked really well-written paragraphs that don't really fit, but maybe I can use it somewhere else. So I parked the text. That's a great point. Are there other questions?
One question that I really appreciate being asked again, even though the both of you did an awesome job sort of touching on the mental hurdles that are part of this process, we have a question. Do you have any tips for students and faculty for overcoming fear of feedback. And I've actually heard some people describe this process as sort of like a hazing. So do you have any other tips for overcoming that fear of the feedback?
Sure.
I would start after and then I'll go.
Okay. So I think knowing that the first time you read it, a normal response is, this is trash and they're wrong. Like, that's a normal internal response. I think I've had it a lot of times. And setting it down and walking away, right? And I think one of the most insightful experiences I had was giving my paper and giving the feedback to a friend after I felt that it was trash and they're wrong. And I was like, yeah, so what did you think of this feedback? And she's like, oh, they're absolutely right. Like, and that a lot of times it's not that you're wrong or that the point that you made was wrong. It's that you're not explaining it clearly enough. The reviewer is essentially is reviewing your work without any context. They're not sitting inside of your head. They don't know all the connections that you're making. So they're ultimately asking you to make some more connections to help them understand what you're trying to say. And I think to the extent that we can take out of it that it's a personal thing, right? Or like, oh, they're being mean to me. They don't know who you are. You're just, you know, a sheet of paper. And that while it doesn't feel this way, they're trying to help you make your work better and make your work more clear. I think sometimes that has been very helpful to me. Like I do not like get the feedback and immediately jump in and try to fix it. I take a step away from it sometimes for many days and then come back to it and first focus on organizing it. Like, are there some consistent themes that I'm starting to see across it? Like, oh, I'm not aligning the conceptual framework very well with my findings. Like, they don't get it. And these are the connections I'm making in my head. I need to do a better job of putting that on the paper. Or like, oh yeah, I didn't explain that term clearly. And that's why this doesn't make sense. I think kind of switching from this is my personal piece of work and my baby to how can I make it better and how can I help them see in it what I want people to see in my work has been really, really helpful. But doing whatever you can to kind of depersonalize it, but knowing that you're gonna have that personal hit to your heart at first.
Good advice. Yeah.
And they are, when we send them out. So it does sort of hurt initially. But I have found that being part of the process, like being a reviewer and being out there, you sort of see that you shouldn't take it personally. This is sort of how the process works. This is how all our work gets better, you know, and the more you sort of do it and participate in different parts of the process, you have a larger perspective versus just spending a year and a half writing your one child and send it out. You know, you're going to feel wounded. But the more you sort of get involved in the process as a reviewer, get involved in different papers. So the more you do, the more you feel, you know, you feel less attached to each individual child. But that's sort of ways that have helped over the years.
Yeah, what you practice goes strong.
I'm sorry, Dr. Griffin. We just have 2 minutes left, and I want to try to get in at least one other question. We had another question come in. And it just went away. There's a question about cultural representation. How important is cultural representation on editorial boards, researchers, and or the subject matter in research?
Oh, and I actually did have a point about that, because I think we need to acknowledge that there is some structural problems in the field, that we need more racial representation on editorial boards, as reviewers, as writers. That's why I encourage you to get involved in the process so we can start to change this, both in publishing but also reviewing, and maybe do enough reviews and they might pick you to be an editorial board or pick you to be an associate editor. So I definitely know that there's a hole. In terms of the lack of diversity and representation in the structural components. So I'm just trying to bring in as many people as we can to help sort of rectify that.
Absolutely.
And this hopefully will be a step, you know, to bring all of you all into the process.
This event is one step in that direction to address that really important issue. We have so many other questions that we're just not going to be able to get to in the 1 minute left, but do you have any closing remarks, Drs. Griffin and Ward, as we close out today's webinar?
I think to the point that was earlier about like feeling that this process can beat you up a little bit, and you know you can be fearful about engaging in it. I would say like what you practice gets stronger. Keep at it. Stay motivated. Keep submitting your work. And be mindful of the kind of feedback that you're getting. Ask for help in the context of this process. We've all gotten tough rejections. We've all got, in some ways, tough rise and resubmits are almost harder because it, you just want to set it aside. But, you know, again, you're still in the game. Do the work of doing those hard R&Rs. You'll learn a lot in the process. And I promise it gets easier over time. You just have to keep practicing. And even, you know, I'm sure Dr. Ward feels this way too. Even at this stage in the game, I have so much to learn about writing. I still get my papers rejected sometimes. I still get hard R&Rs. It's just part of the process. And it, we have to separate our worth from our work. Our work can always be better, but it isn't saying anything about you as a person. You're still good and smart and all those other things. This is just a skill to be honed over time.
Well said. I couldn't say it any better. Yeah, I know where I'm from.
With that, I want to thank everyone for joining us today. We're going to figure out a way to answer the remaining questions here because they're really important, and we really want to equip our Bowie community with the answers that we feel they deserve to have to go forward and be a part of this process because we need you. So thank you, everyone, for joining us today. Please look out for the email to access the recorded version of this webinar, and take care. Thank you so much.
Be well, everybody.
Be well.